Welcome to Tilling the Soil. I am your host, Mr. Jason. Thank you for joining me once again, and I'd love to see you show up to view this week's installment. So you can type the names of those watching in the comments below, and at the end, I'd love to read your answers to Pastor Kevin's Question from Kids segment. And first things first, before we get into the lesson, let's begin in prayer. Dear Lord, thank you so much for allowing us to gather this way again as a digital small group to come together for our Monday night Bible study, Lord. Thank you so much for bringing us together to look at your word, to look deeper into the lessons from Sunday and Wednesday, and just looking at your word, studying it, seeing the lessons you have for us and the way we can apply them to our lives in a better way. So please help us to open our hearts here tonight so that we can grow in your word. And I pray these things in the name of your son, Jesus. Amen. And now it's time for the Bible verse. I'll say the verse, then you can repeat after me. For godly grief produces repentance that leads to salvation without regret. But worldly grief produces death. 2 Corinthians 7:10. This unit's memory verse comes from the second epistle, the second letter Paul wrote to the early Christian church in Corinth, 2 Corinthians. And if we remember back to last week's lesson on Esther, we'll remember that the account of Esther was very much our memory verse lived out as an example. That godly grief, godly worry, when we approach the worries and trials that come our way with our eyes focused on the kingdom of God, then our grief leads to repentance. But when we focus on the things of the world and the worries of the world, that grief leads us to worldliness, leads us to a separation from the Lord, to death, both physically and, more importantly, spiritually. But 2 Corinthians has many lessons Paul was trying to explain to the church. So let's take a look at another one from 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 11 through 15. O Corinthians, we have spoken openly to you. Our heart is wide open. You are not restricted by us, but you are restricted by your own affections. Now in return for the same I speak to as to children, you also be open. Paul's letting the church know, really he's explaining to them, that he and his companions came to Corinth to spread the gospel of Christ in love, with a completely open heart, welcoming them into the love and fellowship that comes from a life lived in submission to Christ. Paul is telling them that the restrictions, that the things that are holding those in this church back from growing in Christ and in the Holy Spirit weren't brought on by Paul and his companions, but were instead brought on by their own affections. Affections for the worldliness around them. Affections and desires to still be accepted by those still living sinful lives around them. The church in Corinth, much like us, are called to be holy, to be set apart from the worldliness, the sinfulness around us. But those in the church in Corinth, much like us, have had a difficult time separating themselves apart. Had a difficult time separating themselves from the sinfulness all around them. After all, sinfulness can bring momentary happiness, momentary excitement to our lives. That's why and how sin is tempting. But we can't have any part of that. And that's why we need to set ourselves apart from it, to lessen and fight the temptation of sinfulness, of chasing happiness and excitement instead of living in joy. Do not be unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship has righteousness with lawlessness? And what communion has light with darkness? And what accord has Christ with Baal? Or what part has a believer with an unbeliever? This is so vitally important for a believer to accept and follow in order to have a Christian walk that produces less stress and less heartache. But sadly, it's a principle so many Christians refuse to take to heart. And without fail, they will regret it. The idea of being unequally yoked is to have two people of unequal strength tied together. In this case, a believer tied together in a partnership with an unbeliever. You might think, well, how am I supposed to spread the gospel to everyone if I avoid unbelievers? But see, this isn't speaking about avoiding unbelievers, not about avoiding others, but to not tie yourself to an unbeliever. The most common example of this is a believer falling in love with an unbeliever and marrying them, thinking that the strength of their belief in the Lord will eventually lead the unbeliever to Christ. But honestly, this rarely happens. More often than not, the unbeliever actually pulls the believer down in their faith, or pulls them from it altogether. We spoke about marriage a bit last week, but a good godly marriage should be one that causes both the husband and the wife to be raised to new heights in Christ, not one that stays the same or brings one or both people down. But being unequally yoked doesn't stop at marriage. It can be any partnership, really, business, friendship. Paul wrote to this same church in Corinth earlier in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 33, "Do not be deceived. Evil company corrupts good habits." So we always need to remember, while we shouldn't push unbelievers away from us, we need to always be aware to not allow ourselves to become unequally yoked, because our priority needs to be growth in the Lord, so we can help spread the gospel for the growth of His kingdom. So now, let's get loosened up a bit before we head into our main Bible video by listening and moving along to our Bible verse song with Miss Bella. And now, since everyone's loose, let's get to this week's Bible video.
God's people had lived in Babylon for 70 years. Then King Cyrus, the king of Persia, took over Babylon and let them go home. Some of God's people went home to Judah, but some of them stayed in Babylon. Nehemiah stayed and worked for the king of Persia. One day, some men came from Judah. Nehemiah asked, "How are God's people in Jerusalem?" The men had bad news. "The people are in trouble. The walls around Jerusalem are broken down and the gates are burned down." Nehemiah sat down and cried. Then he spent time praying and fasting. The king noticed Nehemiah and asked, "What's wrong? Why are you sad?" Nehemiah was afraid. No one was supposed to be sad around the king. Nehemiah said, "The city where my ancestors are from is in ruins." The king sent Nehemiah to Jerusalem. Nehemiah led the people to start rebuilding the walls and gates. The workers put in doors, bolts, and bars. They cut stones and lifted them into place on the wall, and they filled in gaps and holes. All around the city, people worked side by side. Soon, the wall was half as tall as it had once been. But not everyone was happy that Jerusalem's walls were being rebuilt. Some men who lived nearby made a plan to attack them and stop their work. God's people prayed and chose men to guard the walls all day and all night, but the people were discouraged. Nehemiah reminded the people that God was with them. "Don't be afraid," he said. "God is great and powerful. Be ready. If our enemies attack us, God will fight for us." Enemies could threaten God's people, but they could not make God's people stop building. Their enemies were not in charge of rebuilding the wall. God was. So God's people went back to work. Some stood guard with weapons, and others worked on the wall. Some men worked with one hand and held a weapon in the other. They were always ready to fight, just in case. Nehemiah was a wise and good leader for God's people. In just 52 days, the wall was complete. The gates were repaired, and the wall was restored. The city was ready for more of God's people to come home. When all of Jerusalem's enemies heard that the wall had been rebuilt, they were afraid because they knew God was with his people. Nehemiah led the people to rebuild the walls around Jerusalem to protect them from their enemies. Jesus came to protect us from our greatest enemies, sin and death. He died on the cross and rose from the dead to rescue everyone who trusts in him.
This week's Bible video covered Nehemiah returning to the home he never knew, the city of Jerusalem, to rebuild the walls of the city that have continued to lay in rubble for now close to 100 years, following the destruction of the city by the Babylonians under King Nebuchadnezzar. So let's begin our study tonight from Nehemiah chapter 1, verses 8 through 11. "Remember, I pray, the word that you commanded your servant Moses, saying, 'If you are unfaithful, I will scatter you among the nations.'" The book of Nehemiah begins with Hanani, the brother of Nehemiah, returning from Jerusalem, and after learning of the sorry state the city was still in, even after the former Hebrew exiles began returning to Jerusalem about 90 years before, Nehemiah basically collapsed in sorrow, in sadness, and wept for the city he had never known. It's important to keep in mind, Nehemiah was born in the Persian Empire. He had never been to Israel, had never been to Jerusalem, had never seen the city, or its temple, or its walls. But learning of the walls still being collapsed and destroyed brought him great sadness and a deep mourning, a deep grief over the loss of his ancestors' former home. And this morning led Nehemiah to seek the Lord. Seek the Lord in fasting and prayer, days of prayer. And that's what verses 8 through 11 are, a part of Nehemiah's prayer to the Lord. "But if you return to me and keep my commandments and do them, though some of you were cast out to the farthest part of the heavens, yet I will gather them from there and bring them to the place which I have chosen as a dwelling for my name." God had made a promise to his people through Moses to scatter the unfaithful, which God did during the exile, but also made a promise through Moses and many other prophets who followed to bring those of his people who repented and turned back to him, to bring those people back to the place God had chosen as a dwelling for his name. And of course, we know that place became Jerusalem. "Now these are your servants and your people whom you have redeemed by your great power and by your strong hand. O Lord, I pray, please let your ear be attentive to the prayer of your servant and to the prayer of your servants who desire to fear your name. And let your servant prosper this day, I pray, and grant him mercy in the sight of this man." Nehemiah's prayer is one of asking the Lord to honor the promises God had made throughout the history of his people, through the prophets. But I want to focus on "and let your servant prosper this day." See, Nehemiah wasn't praying for the Lord to take care of the fallen walls of Jerusalem. He wasn't praying for the Lord to relieve him of the stress and worries over the situation back in the city he'd never known. Nehemiah was praying for the Lord to make him prosper, to make him successful, because Nehemiah wasn't going to sit on the sidelines and hope the Lord took care of everything. Nehemiah was telling the Lord that he was the Lord's tool, that he was willing to be the one the Lord would work through to complete the task, to complete the job. Just as we spoke about with Esther, we need to understand that wherever we are, whatever we are doing, we may very well be in that exact place at that exact time to do something that glorifies the Lord. After all, our faith isn't a spectator sport. We aren't to spend our time sitting on the sidelines. We're to be living out our faith. That's an action. We are to be active in our faith, to spread the gospel, to be available and open to the Holy Spirit moving inside us and through us to accomplish great things. And Nehemiah wants to be that man, the one who is actively living out his faith for the glory of the Lord. For I was the king's cupbearer. And here we come to who Nehemiah was. What he did, he was the king's cupbearer. And the cupbearer was an important position in the courts of the ancient kings. While they were servants, they were among the king's most trusted servants. They were responsible for serving the drinks of the kings and protecting them from being poisoned. Often by testing the drinks themselves in the presence of the king so the ruler would know that they were safe to drink. And this trust often led to the cupbearer of the king becoming a confidant, someone the king would be open and honest with, or someone with a level of affection the king would have for them, some level of kindness and concern that the king would show to them. After all, it was then, and it still is now, very difficult to surround yourself with people who can be trusted completely. And that's what we're going to get to next, the concern and affection the Persian king felt for his servant. So let's move on to Nehemiah chapter 2, verses 1 through 10. And it came to pass in the month of Nisan, in the 20th year of King Artaxerxes, when wine was before him, that I took the wine and gave it to the king. There are a few things to note in this chapter. One, this account takes place some 40 years or so after the account of the book of Esther, with Artaxerxes, the son of Xerxes, now being the king of Persia. Now, Artaxerxes is thought to have been the stepson of Esther. So that fact could explain why the king acts in the fashion he does throughout this account. King Artaxerxes was also the king who allowed the priest and scribe Ezra to lead a second wave of exiles back to Jerusalem roughly 13 years before this account in Nehemiah takes place. And lastly, chapter 2 here comes to pass in the month of Nisan, the month of April, basically. Nehemiah had learned of the corrupted walls and wept and prayed about them beginning in the month of December. 4 months Nehemiah spent in prayer over the walls, not a few hours, not a day or two, 4 months. See, when we are in need, we have to seek the face of the Lord in prayer. But we can't get in the habit of thinking he answers us on our time. God answers us on his time, his perfect timing. We can't allow ourselves to get discouraged in our prayers. We can't allow ourselves to become disheartened by thinking we aren't hearing from him or that he isn't listening to us. We have to make sure we continue to seek him, that we pray and pray often for him to move in our lives and to move us to where we need to be successful in his plan, where he needs us to be so we can glorify his name. Now I had never been sad in his presence before. Therefore the king said to me, "Why is your face sad since you are not sick? This is nothing but the sorrow of the heart." So I became dreadfully afraid. Let's first address the fear Nehemiah felt. See, in those days, even showing sadness or really anything less than happiness in the presence of a king or ruler could lead to severe punishment or death. Often in those times, kings saw themselves as being gods. So showing anything less than excitement to be in their presence was seen as an insult to the king. But this is what I was speaking of a few minutes ago when I said affection kings could sometimes develop for their cupbearers. See, Artaxerxes notices that Nehemiah isn't looking like himself. But not only that, he knows that Nehemiah is looking saddened and heartbroken. Well, let's go back up to the last one. So it said, "So I became dreadfully afraid and said to the king, 'May the king live forever. Why should my face not be sad when the city, the place of my father's tombs, lies waste and its gates are burned with fire?'" Nehemiah was terrified. He records that himself. But he recognized that this was the moment he had been praying for, the very moment he had been praying the Lord to provide for him. And Nehemiah didn't want to let that moment pass him by. He lived his faith. He acted for the glory of the Lord and answered the king with complete honesty. "Then the king said to me, 'What do you request?'" This is something that happens so infrequently, so little, when honesty is met with genuine concern, with real kindness. But here we see it. Nehemiah spills his heart out, and the king is moved to action himself. He wants to know how he can help. This may be something that happens far less often than it should, but always keep in mind, if we don't respond in honesty to those who care about us, they can never show us or our problems and worries genuine concern or kindness. We need to remember to always give those who love us a chance to show us the love and concern they have for us. "So I prayed to the God of heaven, and I said to the king, 'If it pleases the king, and if your servant has found favor in your sight, I ask that you send me to Judah, to the city of my father's tombs, that I may rebuild it.'" So with this one final mental prayer, one final prayer in his mind for strength from the Father, Nehemiah boldly asked the king to allow him to leave the king's court and his palace and his trusted position to return to Jerusalem and rebuild the city and its walls. "Then the king said to me, the queen also sitting beside him, 'How long will your journey be, and when will you return?' So it pleased the king to send me, and I set him a time." How amazing of an answer is that? I mean, really, the king could have punished Nehemiah, but instead, the king basically just asks him how long he'll be gone. That's an incredible testament to the care Artaxerxes had for Nehemiah and the quality of servant Nehemiah was for the king. How valuable the king considered his cupbearer. "Furthermore, I said to the king, 'If it pleases the king, let letters be given to me for the governors of the region beyond the river, that they must permit me to pass through till I come to Judah, and a letter for Asaph, the keeper of the king's forest, that he must give me timber and make beams for the gates of the citadel which pertains to the temple, for the city wall and for the house that I will occupy.'" Now this may seem like Nehemiah is getting a bit greedy here in these verses, but really this is just Nehemiah understanding how the empire operated and understanding what he'd realistically need to accomplish the task the Lord set before him. "And the king granted them to me according to the good hand of the God upon me, or my God upon me. Then I went to the governors in the region beyond the river and gave them the king's letters. Now the king had sent captains of the army and horsemen with me. When Sanballat the Horonite and Tobiah the Ammonite official heard it, they were deeply disturbed that a man had come to seek the well-being of the children of Israel." With his requests granted, Nehemiah sets out for the city of his forefathers. And we see here the introduction, essentially, to the antagonists, the bad guys, basically, of Nehemiah's time in Jerusalem. Now let's skip down a bit to Nehemiah chapter 2, verses 15 through 20. "So I went up in the night by the valley and viewed the wall. Then I turned back and entered by the valley gate and so returned. And the officials did not know where I had gone or what I had done. I had not yet told the Jews, the priests, the nobles, the officials, or the others who did the work." See, upon entering Jerusalem, Nehemiah was being treated like an important official of the Persian Empire, which he kind of was. But that wasn't helping him to accomplish what he came to the city to do. So after being in the city for 3 days, Nehemiah left with a few of the soldiers who came to Jerusalem with him, and quietly went outside the city to inspect the damage to the outer walls and what needed to be done, to figure out how to go about reconstructing the walls of the city. See, when we take on a task, especially one as large as the one Nehemiah was undertaking, we can't just jump into action. We need to take time and assess the situation. We need to plan and plan well. Then I said to him, "You see the distress that we are in now, how Jerusalem lies in waste and its gates are burned with fire? Come and let us build the wall of Jerusalem, that we may no longer be a reproach." So after several days and after getting a first-hand look at the condition of the walls, Nehemiah tells the Hebrews living in Jerusalem his purpose. His purpose for coming from the palace of the king to rebuild the walls. So the city and its people would no longer be in fear of attacks, and so they wouldn't be in reproach, to be disgraceful in the eyes of the Lord, and for the Lord's city to no longer be disgraceful in the eyes of the enemies of the Lord's people. And I told them of the hand of my God which had been good upon me, and also the king's words that he had spoken to me. Nehemiah doesn't tell them his plan, but also of the plan the Lord had for him, and the hand the Lord had in bringing him this far, and getting the king to give him all the permissions he needed. So that way they knew they were doing it under the royal authority and didn't have to worry, much like a couple of generations ago they had to before they got the temple rebuilt. So they said, "Let us rise up and build." Then they set their hands to this good work. But when Sanballat the Horonite, Tobiah the Ammonite official, and Geshem the Arab heard of it, they laughed at us and despised us and said, "What is this thing that you are doing? Will you rebel against the king?" These new enemies of the people of Jerusalem, much like the old enemies of the returned exiles during the days of Zerubbabel, began to try to dissuade, tried to convince the Jewish people to stop building the walls through words, through mockery and false accusations. This is something we Christians face in our time today quite often. Mockery for our beliefs and false accusations about what we believe. False accusations about our motives for wanting to spread the gospel. But when this happens, we need to take a page out of Nehemiah's playbook. So I answered them and said to them, "The God of heaven himself will prosper us. Therefore, we his servants will arise and build, but you have no heritage or right or memorial in Jerusalem." We need to stand firm on the firm foundation of the Lord, on his promises to us and the evidence of his wondrous works in our lives. God prospers his children. Not prosper in material wealth, though he sometimes does that as well, but prospers us in the things of the Spirit. Material wealth will fade away. It's nothing but vanity in the end. But the things of the Spirit are eternal. Those will last forever. And unfortunately for them, unfortunately for the unbelievers, those mocking us, those making false accusations against us, they have no heritage in the kingdom of God. Those mocking us, whether those unbelievers want to accept it or not, they are at enmity with God, are at odds with God. They aren't counted among his children, so they don't share in the gift of salvation in eternal life that we do. Now, they can share in it, though. They truly can. That's why, even though they are our enemies, so to speak, we need to pray for them. Pray they accept the narrow path to the Father in Christ like we have. Pray they aren't like these three trying to keep the Jews from rebuilding the city of God. These three who wanted nothing to do with the prosperity and glory of the Lord. And that those mocking us, those making false accusations against us, come to know the glory of God and accept the gift of salvation that comes from the shed blood of Christ. So now, how about we get up and move to a bonus song with Ms. Faith.
Our God and
So let's see how this week's lesson connects back to Christ. As we see in our Christ connection, Nehemiah led the people to rebuild the walls around Jerusalem to protect them from their enemies. Jesus came to protect us from our greatest enemies, sin and death. He died on the cross and rose from the dead to rescue everyone who trusts in him. So to connect our lesson back to Christ, I want to return to the book of Nehemiah to look at a few more verses about the building of the wall. So let's begin in Nehemiah chapter 4, verses 1 through 3. But it so happened when Sanballat heard that we were rebuilding the wall, that he was furious and very indignant and mocked the Jews. And he spoke before his brethren and the army of Samaria and said, "What are these feeble Jews doing? Will they fortify themselves? Will they offer sacrifices? Will they complete it in a day? Will they revive the stones from the heaps of rubbish, stones that are burned?" As we see, Sanballat is still mocking the rebuilding of the temple walls, or the walls of the city, I should say. But as we can also see, the situation has escalated a bit. It has become more intense and dangerous, as he's now doing the mocking to the army of Samaria. His mocking attitude now has a threat behind it, the threat of the Samaritans not allowing the rebuilding to happen without a fight. Now, Tobiah the Ammonite was beside him, and he said, "Whatever they build, if even a fox goes up on it, he will break down their stone wall." Tobiah, like so many unbelievers throughout history and today, couldn't bring himself to understand what the Jewish people in Jerusalem toiling away at the walls understood, or what we always need to keep in mind and understand. That, sure, if we try to build with our own hands, by our own knowledge, placing the things of man first, then sure, even something as light as a fox can topple the walls we build for ourselves. But if we build on the foundation of the Lord, if we are building by his guidance, then nothing can topple those walls. If we build ourselves up by his word, with his spirit, and in his will, then nothing can topple or tear us down. But for now, let's skip down to verses 15 through 20 of chapter 4. "And it happened when our enemies heard that it was known to us, and that God had brought their plot to nothing, that all of us returned to the wall, everyone to his work." Sanballat and the others actually planned a surprise attack against what they thought would be unsuspecting builders. But their plot had been discovered by fellow Hebrews living outside of the city ahead of time, and the workers at the walls were ready to defend themselves, causing their enemies to think twice about their attack and turn back. "So it was from that time on that half my servants worked at construction while the other half held the spears, the shields, the bows, and war armor, and the leaders were behind all the house of Judah." So the Hebrews come up with a game plan to work in shifts, building and defending, relying on each other and on the Lord. And to ensure on that reliance, to ensure that those stationed at the walls to defend would fight with everything they had, Nehemiah split up the groups by family, so the defenders would be stationed beside their own family members. Because as we all know, a typical person will fight for no one else as hard and as fiercely as they will for their own family. This split by the families is actually recorded up in verse 13, which was just before we picked back up. "Those who built on the wall and those who carried burdens loaded themselves so that with one hand they worked at construction, and with the other held a weapon. Every one of the builders had his sword girded at his side as he built." As Christians, we are promised salvation from our sins and spiritual prosperity. Not to be free of burdens, not to be free of trials, not freedom from attack. So we need to arm ourselves, to prepare ourselves for hard times to come our way. We need to be at the ready to defend ourselves from the spiritual attacks that come our way as we carry our burdens and doubts. As we try to raise the walls of our faith, we need to make sure that we have that sword of the Spirit on us at all times. We need to make sure we know and can use the power of God's will the power of God's word whenever we need it during the walking out of our faith. And the one who sounded the trumpet was beside me. Then I said to the nobles, the rulers, and the rest of the people, the work is great and extensive, and we are separated far from one another on the wall. Whenever you hear the sound of the trumpet, rally to us there. Our God will fight for us. And while we should be at the ready, we need to be at the ready, really, all the time. But as we're at the ready, armed with prayer, his word, and our faith in him to see us through our trials, we always need to remember that we aren't alone. We can't be shy. We can't be timid and afraid to call on our brothers and sisters in the faith, to rally them around us in times of need, asking for their help, asking for their support, asking for their prayers to help us combat whatever battle we find ourselves in the midst of, to help us shoulder our burdens. Everyone needs help at some point. And while, yes, we have the Lord of all creation in our corner with us, we need other people as well. And this isn't some New Age, non-biblical teaching. It's from Genesis. Genesis 2:18, to be specific. And the Lord God said, "It is not good that man should be alone. I will make him a helper comparable to him." We need the support of other believers. The Lord placed them in our path for such a time as that. So make use of the Lord's provisions. Make use of our friends. And do good in the eyes of the Lord. And now, finally, let's flip over to Nehemiah chapter 6, verses 15 through 16. So the wall was finished on the 25th day of Iyul in 52 days, and it happened when all our enemies heard of it, and all the nation around us saw these things, that they were very disheartened in their own eyes, for they perceived that this work was done by our God. There is nothing our enemies hate more than good works being done for God or by God. Nothing causes them to swell up with anger quite like watching the Lord be glorified. And it doesn't matter what it is. Charity work, missionary work, healthcare work, outreach. If the Lord is being glorified, it angers them. See, unbelievers, they know they're living in sin. And them seeing the truth lived out before them causes them to feel convicted inside. And they don't like that very much. They don't want to feel convicted. They want to continue living the sinful lives they've created for themselves, no matter how miserable those lives make them. Because they don't want to imagine there is anything better for them. They don't want to admit they lied to themselves. They don't want to admit that they will be held accountable for their sinful living by a just and righteous God. But like the Hebrews showed here, showed the glory of the Lord to their enemies through their good works, we need to do the same. See, good works don't lead to salvation for us, but our good works could lead someone else to the glory of God and the acceptance of Christ. So we need to continue to do good works in his name. No matter the hate that comes our way, no matter the attacks we may have to fend off, no matter the burdens we have to shoulder, we must do good in his name, for his glory, and reflect the light of his love and the truth of his kingdom on all who see us. And now, it's time to prep ourselves for the Pastor Kevin Shuffle. To your ready positions. Are you set?
Hi there, I'm Pastor Kevin. It's time for questions from kids. Philip from Cleveland, Ohio asks,
"Why does the Bible say God fights for his people? I thought fighting was bad."
That's an interesting question. You're right. He does fight for us, and we need him to fight for us. The Bible also says that it is good that God fights for us. And you are correct. You know, instigating a fight is bad. It's wrong. It It's sinful. It's ungodly. But God doesn't start fights. He just comes and helps us because he knows, God knows, that Satan is always seeking to harm us. Our main enemy is not the people we see. Our main enemy is the sin in our hearts and that is displayed in our lives. The Bible says Jesus protects us from our enemies. Jesus protects us from sin and even from death. And I hope you believe that. Hope you believe it in your heart. How does Jesus protect us from our enemies, sin, and death?
So now I want to hear from you in the comment section. How does Jesus protect us from our enemies, sin, and death? Now, let's get a leader's perspective.
Let's see this week's question. How does Jesus protect us from our enemies, sin, and death? Well, for a quick answer, we're protected from sin and death by the shed blood of Christ. Like the blood of the Passover lamb that covered the doorposts and lintels of the Hebrews in ancient Egypt, the blood of Christ causes the perfect justice of God's wrath to pass us by. As all the Lord sees is us cloaked head to toe in the glory and righteousness of his son Jesus. Jesus' sacrifice gave us this gift, the gift promised to Adam and Eve in the garden after they ate of the fruit, that one day their descendants would rise up and crush the head of the serpent. And that's what Jesus did on the cross. He freed all who placed their faith and trust in him from the curse of that original sin. Hope this helped. And maybe I'll answer another question myself soon. Anyway, let's get to our closing prayer next.
I have no idea who that handsome young man was, but I hope everyone had a great time tonight. And let's close in prayer. Dear Lord, please bless those who came out to watch tonight and will watch in the future. Please bless those who are struggling with health, struggling with finding definition in their lives. I know it's things that we have spoken about over the last few months, but just please bless those around us, those we love, those we pray for each and every day, because we are an answer to someone's prayer as well. It said that everyone that comes to Christ was an answer to someone else's prayer, because there was someone else in your life who knew you, who met you, who might have been no more than an acquaintance, who was praying for your salvation and was praying for the salvation of each and every one of us. So please bless everyone we love with health and growth and finding themselves in the only definition that matters, the only identity that matters, and that is in you. So Lord, please help us as we go through our week, as we go through our long week here from the beginning, and just bless us as we go through each and every step. Bless us so that not we can feel good about ourselves and feel good about our accomplishments and feel special and better than those around us. But please bless us, Lord, so that we can go forth and glorify your name. So we can build up our faith like Nehemiah building the walls and go out and glorify your name through great deeds. And I pray these things in the name of your son, Jesus. Amen. And with that, blessings to everyone watching, and I hope to see you again next week for Tilling the Soil.